What we tried to do is take some of the ideas that you heard about briefly this morning for these regional talent innovation networks, and will it work here? And if it would, what would it look like? How would it be organized? Who'd do it? What are the projects? So we have three teams of your peers representing business, education, labor, nonprofits, K-12, higher ed, et cetera. They have worked on this very hard.
All right, so we went through a bunch of different questions, so I'll read the questions and kind of go through what our group came up with. So first question is to explore. So develop ideas that you can implement with the widest spectrum of community partners. And so our group really talked a lot about the South Dakota Education Campus, which if hopefully a lot of you are familiar with that, but it's a relatively new entity. It's been being talked about for quite a while, maybe over the last year or two, but we have classes going. So really it's Brookings' way of trying to get our own technical school since we don't have a state-funded technical school. So a lot of different groups came together to help make that happen. We got people into classes now. And so we thought that that particular entity matched up pretty well with a lot about what we were talking about. So some of the groups that make up the South Dakota Education Campus are the K-12 system, SDSU, Department of Labor. We are using Minnesota West as a partner to help deliver some classes and to maybe help with some guidance on how to operate this entity. There's a lot of industry involvement and as well as funding from industry. And so that, and we've got the state and a lot of different groups that are involved in it. So we just kind of listed off a lot of those entities and thought the South Dakota Education Campus was something that came pretty close to what we were trying to talk about here. So the next one is focus and carefully choose what to do. Okay, so that's down here. So we want to try to define what our manpower needs are with the right skill set to fill the jobs that are open in town. And so we're looking at providing training and recruitment and retention. And we talked a little bit about some different areas that we could pull additional people from that might be looking to, that are either underemployed or not employed, that might not be traditional. So focusing on trailing spouses as we recruit families into the area, that there might be some trailing spouse opportunities, you know, to get them working and get them the training they need to fill the jobs in the area. Veterans, it's not listed on the list here, but we talked about even people from the Department of Corrections that might be you know, good candidates to fill jobs in the area. And the top one just says we need to be able to do background checks quicker, because I think some employers are losing people because we can't do background checks fast enough. Okay, item number three was align, identify and align local resources to help you accomplish initiatives. And we came up with a lot of the same groups as I listed off in number one. So the South Dakota Education Campus, Vision Brookings, BEDC, K-12, employers, SDSU, the city and the state, and a lot of the different entities that we have in town. So the next one was execute. How are we going to measure the results? How do we know that we're successful? So we thought of a few different ideas on what we could measure. One of them would be how many people are employed in the region. So let's define what the region is, look at how many people are employed, and then we can monitor that as time goes along. If we're actually increasing employment, then we know that we're creating more jobs, creating opportunities for people are here and attracting people into the area. And we can look at employment rates or unemployment rates too, but as you learned this morning, sometimes those aren't always the most accurate measurements. But the raw number of people we thought would be a pretty fair measure of are we increasing employment or not. And then the penetration rate, which is the number of positions written versus the positions that we're filling. and also could measure the number of students that we have at SDEC, as well as maybe the number of students that are in the K-12 system, number of students at SDSU. And then another measurement that I know we already track is what's the average wage in the county. And certainly we can look and see, are we able to drive that average wage up? In other words, are we attracting and filling positions that are creating more wealth and giving people opportunities to increase their pay? So that's an existing measurement. We can certainly benchmark against that. Okay, so number five is, what is your vision? And so we kind of made it pretty simple here. We're really just looking at business growth and wealth creation. So we want our businesses to grow, business opportunities to grow, and we want to create more wealth in the area. And then what are our next steps? We thought that there's a lot of groups in town already that are involved in economic development. There's BEDC, ADC, EDC, the Chamber, Downtown Brookings, Vision Brookings, the list goes on. And so we, SDEC, we got a lot of groups, so we really need to maybe do a good inventory of what all exists and then try to identify either certain leaders that we can put together to help move this idea forward, or maybe better yet, pick an existing group that represents, that has a good cross representation of the entire community, business community, education, government, parents, students, something along that lines where we have a good representation, and use that group to help drive this forward. But we do need to identify leaders that will take ownership and try to move this idea forward, or we're fearful that it will just stall and fail. That's group one.
All right. They have multiple groups already exist. You don't want another bureaucracy to kill off some of the good things that are happening. But the question is, who's making all the parts work together? Who's moving all this together, all right? And who's gonna be the neutral person to bring the groups together, to work together instead of competing against each other for funding and support, which is happening now in too many cases. This SDEC was brought up by two of the groups that already exists. That might be good. They don't have a campus per se, so they're not meeting at the biggest institution in town that's going to take over now and dominate. And that's very important, because many people don't want to get involved because they don't want to be dominated by somebody else. They want to see more of a successful system where everybody gets something. Also, too, they were talking about they want to penetrate and reach into the K-12 system more and bring parents and counselors into whatever is going on. They talked about penetrating, maybe starting into the middle grades. I see them even going down into the primary grades, starting to influence. In fact, one person was telling me about how that happened in her school. Her child's in first grade. They brought in a doctor who is using food items to demonstrate bones and stuff, and the children really got into this, and the doctor, who was very busy, wasn't sure he could stay all day, and he stayed the whole day. He got so interested in working with these kids. And there's something to that, all right? All employers, all groups, and also this inventory is very important, because you need to report back to the community what's going on. You'll read in Future Jobs, there are various models already out there that you can tie into. You don't have to reinvent the wheel again, and you can get some of that information out so that people know what's going on. All right? Okay, so that's group one. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Sarah Perry. I also work at Falcon Plastics. But I also would share with you, I spend a lot of time with our South Dakota Education Campus Task Force, we've been assembled and really talking about this topic of partnerships within Brookings for about the last 2 years, but really more formalized since we started leasing some space out the Research and Technology Center last August. So our group also really shared a lot of the same topics and a lot of the same comments that Jay has already presented. So I'll skip over repeating some of those things. One of the things that Edward shared with us was really an outline. When he presented the topic of a retain and what that might look like here in Brookings, we all saw that this morning, and he actually expanded on that and how you might take steps within your community to make that happen. When we looked at that, a lot of those things we have already started here in Brookings. Jay also touched on inventory and looking to see what already exists within your community and maybe some collaborations that are already going on, some repetition, and how you make sure that you're fully represented. So one of the comments that we had in our group that was maybe a little bit different is in expanding our vision is outside of Brookings. What does that look like? Is it just outside Brookings County or just within Brookings County? Or might we even perhaps suggest Minnehaha County came up in our conversation to really look at this as regional and share what Brookings has to offer that's unique, that's not Sioux Falls, because we all know in here, in this group, that there's a lot we have to offer and presents well to that group. So again, that's part of the vision that we would share with the strategies. Our plan, communication strategy is really to raise awareness and what that looks like. As Jay talked about earlier, on the topic of exploring, we talked more strategies, career fairs at the K-12 schools, getting area businesses into schools to show a spectrum of opportunities. Systematically, what does that look like? So when you build a retain, such as a platform of SCEC, how do you get all those systems working together rather than what we may experience today being these one-offs? You might have a teacher call you and say, hey, can you come present to the class? How can we more systemically make that happen ongoing, not just a project, not just a one-shot opportunity? So systemically getting all those people to work together. Apprenticeships, we heard about that this morning. That also came up in our conversation as a strategy. When we visited about vision and SDEC and the outline that Edward had presented to our group of about 30 people, we really thought that our vision might be too small, that we need to revisit that and really expand and ask ourselves some of those questions about expanding our vision. Okay. We had lots of ideas, so I'm trying to keep it brief so we can get out of here today and picking out those things that maybe haven't been mentioned yet. Measuring results. The net in-migration of population, we felt, would also be a strong measurement for our community. That was discussed earlier this morning as well. Our next step that we would present is hiring a campus director for South Dakota Education Campus and invite other regional leaders and possible stakeholders to partner and participate in that effort. So again, going back to the outline that Edward presented to us, re-examining that and reassessing to see if there's opportunity for us to strengthen that.
So we had a small group, grossly outnumbered by the people at the other two tables, but we had a good discussion. I was the team leader in our group, and I should introduce myself, Al Houghton, Director of Brookings Economic Development Corporation, for those that don't know me. If you do know me, it's not uncommon for me to go down a road less traveled. So that's what we did. I didn't answer any of Ed's questions, I don't think, in our discussion, but we had a good discussion. You know, we started out talking about projects, workforce-related solutions, and then we took those ideas, and rather than trying to list all those, and we can create lists till the cows come home of things that we should do or could do and probably ought to do, we dropped back a little bit, and we talked a little bit about our area, and one of those simple statistics that every year in the Brookings community, Brookings commute region, we have 3,000 new young people between SDSU students that graduate, high school students that graduate. Every year we can have from 500 to 1,000 jobs open and we can't fill them. So we talked a lot this morning about having a jobs and skills disconnect, but we need to add another piece to that. And Ed talked about hyphenation being real important somewhere in his discussion this morning. So we have two hyphens in ours, but there's a desire issue. if we don't have the jobs the kids want, we're never going to fill the jobs unless we can find somebody else from outside the area to come in and take those. So we have the desire, job, skills disconnect that we need to focus on. Rather than listing lots of projects, we tried to lump those into kind of a graphical area that we could pull out some representation for, you know, the kinds of things a retains group should be focusing on. So career awareness is one. We've talked a lot about that today for kids. We talked about using, I think me as the oldest member of our discussion group, when I retire, you know, I'm not going to tell you how soon, but a ways away yet. I don't want to do what I'm doing when I'm 65 years old or after I'm 65. I want to do something different. What is that? You know, what are the options for me going forward or for other baby boomers, you know, as we grow older and want to have a career change? So career awareness is important at lots of different ages, and we don't want to lose sight of that. CTE programming, after you pick up what you're going to do, how do you start the training in school to prepare you for that career? Lifelong learning, you know, we have to continue this for everybody. You know, as people age, decide to change jobs, need new skills, that has to be a piece of what we're doing. Educator education, if the education community doesn't get it, then we need to figure out how to make them get it. And then follow through came up with something that was really important. Somebody in our group brought up the My Life test, right? That there's a test that measures career aptitudes, but then there's not really a follow through process. So we need to do that at all levels. And there are probably a number of other pieces to this, but these are just the primary ones that we pulled out. So we have to get all those different components covered within a retains group. We have to look at the broad picture or the bigger picture, and then we have to be able to follow through and make sure that things get done. And then we talked a little bit about, well, how can we make this happen? It was mentioned a number of times this morning. We need people with passion, and everybody in this group is passionate about this topic, or you wouldn't have been here, you wouldn't have come today, you wouldn't have stayed through the day, so I applaud you for that. This group didn't go home early, thank you. So passion is important. So we need to identify those people with passion that represent all of these areas that are in the retains, and I don't have that graphic. Well, Ed showed this morning. Whether it's parents, students, business, labor, educators, government, you know, there may be more. We need to make sure every area is represented by people with passion that really want to see success occur. And we talked about, you know, how do we include everybody? There's a lot of people to include. We settled on the world is run by those who show up. If you want to be involved, we'll find a way to get you involved in this process. If you don't, then just get out of the way and we'll do it. That's kind of where we're at. So then we talked about two tracks also. You know, we have, you know, the groups that are very pragmatic. Let's get a project. Let's get it done. Let's have some early successes. We need that. But we also have to make sure we're paying attention to the visionary side of this, that it's really easy to get caught up in projects, and that's all you ever do. So the focus is on the project and not necessarily the larger end result that needs to occur at the end of the day. So we need people with passion that will take projects and run with them, people with passion that are going to be more visionary about how this whole process evolves and changes over time. Because it's a system. What works today might not work a year from now and on down the road. So that's the discussion that we had. Thank you.
One time I was talking with a group of business people about lifelong learning. I mentioned this and they all groaned. Because a lot of people in business talk about the year they got out, not out of prison, out of school, all right? I've been with executives who say, you know, I got my MBA, I haven't read a book in 5 years. Now, careers are changing very fast. When I got out of school, I was going to do this. I did start a business in education services, but I wanted to be a professional historian and teach in the history department, which I ended up doing part-time, though my last career teaching was in business. I didn't intend to do this. Maybe what we need to talk about is lifelong career learning. Because everybody, you're a truck driver, that's a career. You're a conductor on a train. You work repairing airplane engines for American Airlines. You're a surgeon. Those are all careers, and they change, and they're changing very fast. I mean, I've written some articles on this for the International Neurological Surgeons Association. I've written articles about this for the Society, the International Society of the Golden Rule. And I keynoted their conference. You know who they are? They're independent funeral directors. What? Why? There's a world shortage of morticians. Did you know that? Because you see, funeral homes were family businesses. And usually, someone in the family, the father, would be a mortician, which requires a bachelor's in science, and then graduate work, and you have to pass a state examination. It's not easy to be a mortician, and every funeral home has to have a mortician. Well, what's been going on in that industry, if you haven't noticed, I haven't, is that they've all been bought up. They're being bought up by huge corporations, and now that chain has been broken. So you don't have a father, someone in their family, a boy or girl becomes a mortician. So guess what? Now we have a shortage of morticians. Thank you very much. Of course, there are people being incinerated now instead of being buried. So you have ashes, all right? But my point is, things are changing very fast. So lifelong career learning is something that I think everybody has to think about. And maybe we need to teach that to children at the elementary school level, starting at a very young age, that in their lifetime, they may end up having three or four different careers. I mean, how many careers have you had now in your life? Some of the gray-haired people. How many careers have you gone through here? And you youngsters sitting here, how many careers do you expect to have before this is over? Well, who's going to control that? I'm not. Your governor isn't. The president isn't. The free enterprise system is going to control a lot of it. Then another interesting fact that you can go to today when you go home is there is already a national website for your state that projects for the next 5 years, and it's updated annually, what are the jobs in your state? How many jobs? What's the entry-level salary? The median? The long-term salary? What are the education requirements? This is on the Career Outlook in US. The website is careeroutlook.us. And it shows for your state, it's in here, it was developed by an occupational expert in North Carolina for his state. And now he has developed this for every state. And it's updated every year. Why? Because your state publishes the data. Now, it's not for your county, but I would suspect if you get a retain going, you could probably put together that for this county from the data that your state has. They just haven't tricked it out. So it would give you a lot of useful and interesting information. And then with it is something called interest profiler. It's 110 questions on this website that a student can answer that identifies two things, your passion and your interest. It's free. And when it gets done and it correlates it, it shows, you know, how many types of intelligence do we have? Well, Sternberg said there are 9 forms of intelligence. There are many different theories, but let's just go with the 9. You have some of it on all 9 areas, fine and gross motor, mathematical, musical, etc. My dad was a carpenter contractor, and he was a great athlete. He wanted to be a coach. He didn't because there was a depression. I can't drive a nail straight. He was on a championship high school football team. I've worn these bifocals since I was 2.5 years old. You throw anything at me, I'll miss it. I'm the last person you want on my team. Why do you think they called me Flash Gordon in high school? I was a disaster. All right. But he couldn't get up and give speeches, and he didn't write books. So he was a genius in those areas. I was a dummy. And in these areas, I have some skills. What about your kids? This will help identify it. And then the nice thing with these two websites, it then takes the notations and the scores and correlates those passions and those aptitudes with the jobs in your state. So it helps you to see what you're good at. Now you may already, you are probably know everything you need to know about yourself. It starts the process though. It starts the conversation in your home. You can do this with your own children. You can do it with yourself. And then obviously at your colleges, community colleges, you have career centers and they have more sophisticated diagnostic assessment tools. What I recommend for every state is what's done in some states. Every sixth grader takes a assessment inventory and interest inventory. Not of their IQ, it's of what maybe they might be interested in as a career. And they get the scores, and the parents come with the child, they sit down in the school, and a qualified counselor goes through it with them when they're in sixth grade. And before that, the school district has started programs to bring in people from different occupations for kids to look at, or take them to a modern high-tech manufacturing facility, or show them a hospital operating theater that's not in use, or whatever, all of these different career areas. This is a good thing for a kid? Yeah, I think it's a real good thing for a kid. I mean, I have a nephew right now, his kindergarten in Colorado was built on the site where they found dinosaurs. And you know how children like dinosaurs? I like dinosaurs. He has all these dinosaurs. So when he was 5 years old, he told my niece Paula, I want to be a paleontologist. She almost fell on the ground. He still wants to be a paleontologist. And he reads like a demon. He's 8 years old and he's reading at about a 12th, age 12 level right now. And one of the things that is his passion is being a paleontologist. Now, I loved history. When I was in graduate school, my PhD professor at the University of Chicago told me after 2 years of being there on a scholarship, Mr. Gordon, there are 5,000 people driving taxi cabs who have PhDs in American history. What are you going to do? Being a carpenter's son, I can't just live off the fat of the land until the job. And I really did not want to leave Chicago. Just like you don't want to see your children leave. I didn't. So I had my little business, so I grew my business. I ultimately finished my doctorate, but not in American history. It was in social and intellectual history and ed psych for learning theory so that I could publish the results of what I've been doing in education and business. And it worked for me, and I still taught history. And now I'm 65, and I'm now doing, besides running this company, I have a hobby. I do history programs on the American West, World War II, and the Civil War in museums all over the U.S. to attract people to attend these museums. Pays a lot less than this, but I love doing it. It's a great hobby. It's another career area. So I ended up sort of cycling back to what I started out with. That's good. And many of you may do the same thing. But think about your career as your life. What's your passion? What's your interest? And as things change and conditions change in where you live, in your community, your environment, take advantage of it. Don't be afraid. That's why the retains work. And they are yours. They're not at institutions. They're the communities. And ultimately, if this works as well as I think it will, ultimately, we'll have a brand new education to employment system right here in South Dakota that'll be highly competitive, just like when you invented the first one in maybe whatever the year was. Maybe it was 1916 when you mandated that first system that created what you have today. These things are doable. Al was talking, in the end, it's about getting her done. Right. You need to do what you can do. You can't do everything, you're not miracle workers, but you can do more, and you can revise the system. So, any questions or comments? No one's thrown anything at me yet today, so I guess you're thinking about it, and you need to think about it. And there's going to be a lot more discussion that this is going to start across your community. But I appreciate the time I've had with you, and I'll be around for the rest of the day. I don't fly back to Chicago till tomorrow, so still you can get that tar and feathers ready for me to ride me out on the rail. Thank you very much.